everybody. Welcome back to another segment. You know, this segment is something I've been looking forward to doing for a long, long time. Today, we're going to show you the installation of a Tesla wall connector in preparation, getting ready for our Model 3. Now, before we begin, I know a lot of you are going to go straight down to the YouTube comments and say, what are you doing? You don't own a Model S. You don't own a Model 3. It's not coming for months. Why are you doing this now? Are you being premature about it? And the answer is no. I'm doing this for you guys so that you will know how to do this if you decide to go this way. And if I make any mistakes, well, you won't repeat them either. The other question people are going to ask is that, do you need this for a Model 3? And the answer is no. What you really should be looking at minimum is a 40 amp circuit, 220 volt, and that's a NEMA 1450. It's a stove socket. That's what you should be putting in your garage or your lean-to or wherever you're going to be charging your vehicle. Now, I know some of you are also going to say, well, I live in an apartment or a condo complex. Do I need to go this route? No, but you need to start thinking about, you know, getting power out to where you happen to, park your vehicle. If you're in that predicament, you need to talk to your, the homeowners association or the property managers about getting that sorted out, because that's going to be a problem for you. So the other thing too is we're in North America, so what I'm saying here basically applies to, you know, Canada and US. Now, the reason I chose the wall connector is because I wanted a permanent installation so that when we bring the car home, we can just plug it in and have it charge without having to dig out the UMC, which is Universal Mobile Connector, that comes with every Tesla. It has the Tesla connector on one end, and then the other end has the interchangeable little bit so you can go into a level one or level two. I don't want to have to deal with that. I'm just going to leave it in the car so that we go for a trip. It's always in the vehicle and I don't have to worry about pulling it out every day. So there's going to be permanent installation. Now, the other thing too is this is not a charger. This is technically an EVSE, or an electric vehicle supply equipment. This is not a charger. The charger for the Tesla is built into the car. All this does is takes the electricity from the wall and converts it into the connector that the Tesla needs, and it has some power electronics in it so that it can communicate with the car so that it knows how much electricity is coming in and out. It basically does the same job as the UMC that comes with the car. However, it has some extra little features. This is the second generation. If I remember correctly, it was updated in August of last year. So I know some of you have commented on Twitter, why don't you wait, because they might come up with a new one. Well, the other one's been in place since, I think, 2012, 2013. I don't think they're going to update it again. I know some of you also said, why are you doing this now? They may change the connector. Really? They're not going to go around and change all the connectors on the superchargers and the destination chargers, which is what this is too, just to accommodate a new connector on the Model 3 and then obsolete all the S's and X's. That's not going to happen. This is going to work just fine on the Model 3. First thing I want to show you is what's in the box, what do you get, all the different parts, and then the second part of this video will be the actual process of the installation when the electrician comes. So, without further ado, I'm not big on unboxings, but you know, I might as well just show you what's in here. So, take this off, we don't need that. Okay, what it comes with is, first things first, it comes with this metal plate. Now, this is what gets installed on the wall, and this is what holds it in position. It has various different holes for mounting, so that's nice to have. This little section right here has some little grommets and little hole, little plugs, so that depending on how you connect your electricity to it, and the actual finishing touches, that has some little, I think these look like little caps for the screws. So that's included in the box. And over here, they give you a little bag of screws. What's interesting in here is they also give you the security bit that's required for the Torx. So you don't have to go buy any tools. This is included, so that's really nice. By the way, I should mention the wall connector here is completely waterproof. It's designed to sit outside or inside the garage, so you can mount this as what we're going to do. We plan on putting this on the side of the garage. And of course, you get the handy dandy manual. We'll take a look a little closer at this, a little closer look at this a little bit later. Oh, by the way, it mentions the wall connector is up to 80 amps. Now, this is one of the unique features of the wall connector, is that it can take up to 80 amps. Now, the Model S, I think if you get the 100 kilowatt hour battery pack, you can order a 72 amp onboard charger. The standard is 48 amp. And since they've put that on 100 kilowatt hour, I don't think it's going to show up on the Model 3. So I think if I was a betting man, the standard charger on a Model 3 will be 48 amp. So this is perfectly doable for a Model 3. But if you had a higher end Model S, you really need this if you want the full 72 amp on there, because a standard EVSE that you would buy, say, off of Amazon or whatever, they usually only give you 40 amps. So this is kind of a requirement if you have the higher end charger. All right, let's have a look here. This part here is an extension, if I remember correctly, that you put on the back of the wall connector. If you if you're going to supply it with electricity from a top mount, this just extends it a little bit. I don't think we're going to end up using this because we're going to come in from the bottom or from the back. So that's an extra part may not need. And of course, lastly, is the actual wall connector itself. It's this, you know, box. It's about 5 inches thick. It sits like that. We'll open that a little bit later when we get around to doing the installation, so you can see all the wiring and the connections. And then the cord is in here wrapped. Now, I should mention, the wall connector from Tesla is available in two cord sizes, 8 foot and 24 foot. And the difference is only about $50 US. So if you want some flexibility, make sure you get the 24 foot cord, because then you can just kind of, depending on how you park the car or where you put it in your garage, you have lots of room to work with. This is available on shop.tesla.com. Don't look at the normal Tesla website. You have to go to the accessories website. So that's basically what you get in the box. So the next part will be the actual install process. So we're outside my house, and one of the reasons I wanted to do this segment was to show you what could be a complicated install. If you have a garage attached to your house and you have power coming into the garage, your installation should be fairly straightforward, even if you do a NEMA 1450, just a standard plug. But my situation is a little different here. The goal here, here's our driveway, and our goal here is to install the wall charger right here, so that when we back up our car, we can just unroll it and plug it in. Now, here's the issue. My garage is separate from the house. We live in a townhouse. Here's my backyard. There's the door. There's about 20 feet here, 6 meters. And the way this works is we have power coming in off the street into the meter. And then there's underground conduit that runs underground through my backyard into the house. And it goes into the main panel in the basement. And then there's a return conduit that comes out and goes through an underground and comes out here and supplies 15 amps to the garage. Now, obviously, that's not enough. We need to run 220 volt. And the amperage will depend on the load that we want to do. So the reason I say this is going to be complicated is because we would have to run some new wire through the conduit, and it's only 1.5 inches. So when the electrician gets here, we'll have to see how difficult this installation is going to be, whether we can actually fish through and pull out some new conduit. The other solution to this would be to run tech cable. Now, tech cable is that big armored stuff, and we could actually run that from the return and along the fence, and then come around, say, sort of the backside here, and then maybe either go inside the garage or just run it along the lintel and then into the wall connector. So we'll be able to determine that when he gets here to see exactly how much work this is. Well, the biggest fears have been alleviated here. We know that the line is continuous. We're able to shove a fish down there.
He's a little slippery. Let me grab a rag.
Oh, okay.
Pardon? It didn't break. It feels too loose.
Oh, he's still going.
How deep did they go? Oh, here we go. Here it is.
So this is a 6-gauge 4-conductor. It runs along the line into the garage.
you got the connectors and everything?
Yeah, I got the connectors.
I have to cut that pipe back a little bit.
Like a glove.
Now, first thing we need to do here is take this base plate cover off. Set that screw in my pocket. Of course, if I say that I can't remember where I put the screw, you're all going to be screaming, Trevor, you put it in your pocket.
It's just held on with little clips all the way around, so we'll just set that aside for now. Now, in this little bag of screws here, there is, as I mentioned before, there's a little Torx bit, security bit. It's got a little nubbin on the end. And you need to use that to take the wall connector apart. All these little screws are on the perimeter. Of course, if you use a nice power tool. Again, going in my pocket. Okay, so eventually when we put this all back together, there is a connector here. And that's what gives us the LED lights here on the front. That's attached with a ribbon cable. We'll do that a little bit later. Here's the inside of the unit. You can see here that there is a silicone or nitrile gasket all the way around, so it's waterproof, so there's no water ingress in here. And then your connectors are going to be in here. We'll do a little close-up of this when we actually get to the wiring, but now let's put it on the wall. And that'll basically sit like that. I got to put four screws here on the sides, and then I'll mount it, and then the electrician should be able to take that wire and put it into the two lugs there. Part of the wiring diagram here is they show you that you're supposed to plug the bottom and the back because there's two holes, but what they don't show you is a diagram how to install the ferrules to hold the wiring in place, so that's what we're struggling with right here at the moment. Okay, so we made a mistake. Ended up using these screws in their dome head, and it's not allowing the unit to sit flush against the wall, so I've got some flathead ones. We'll just have to swap them out. All right, so that concludes the physical installation of the unit, and the last little bit here is to put the protective cover on. And then there's a another security screw. It's a little bit smaller, and it goes into the bottom, just like that. Oh, that's satisfying. On the other end, you've got your standard Tesla connector. This is what goes into the charge port on the car. And then we have 24 feet worth of cable, and it just kind of sits like that, neat and tidy. And on the side of the unit, this is the second generation unit, and there's a holster for the unit, and it just keeps that out of the rain. Just stays like that. The first generation units used to have a separate holster you'd put on the wall, but now this is built in, so nice little finish. Anyway, so that takes care of the hardware installation. Let's go inside and finish up the actual electrical part. Remember, this is a family channel. Hey, it's green. Look at that. All right, so the installation is completed, and you can see that the green status light is on. And it was a very good install that Merrick and his helper Steve came out today to do this.
It wasn't without some challenges, however, so I'm going to very quickly go over some of the issues we had. Let's start on this end, since this is where we're here. There is a metal plate, as I showed before, that gets mounted to the concrete. So I made a couple of mistakes. One is the screws that I used were a pan head rather than flat head, so that was just causing the unit to stick out a little bit too far, so we couldn't get the security screws on the side. So make sure if you're using screws, make sure they're the flat head type so that it can sit flush. The other installation, it's not mentioned in the manual here, but there's a ferrule that needs to be installed on the back of the unit or depending on wherever your power supply comes from. And we had to chisel into the brick a little bit to make it sit flush because the ferrule holds the supply line coming in. So that needs to be secured so that it doesn't pull out. So anyways, we got that kind of sorted out. The other thing too, when you, and I can't show it right here because the cover's on, but the in this case, we ran 6-gauge wires in, and there's a terminal block inside where the two legs of the power come in, and it's sitting on an angle. And what happens is that if you don't insert it correctly, when you go to tighten down the screws, it'll be loose. It's not holding properly. It seems to be that the... It's hard to describe, but the block inside, the terminal block, has like a pinching mechanism. So when you tighten the screw down, it pinches the supply wire. And I can't exactly explain it, but it seems to be that the wire either has to be, and I forget here, either in front or behind where the pinch block is. And if you don't get it in the right position, it won't grab the wire. It'll be loose. And of course, that's a no-no in this case. So it took us about 15, 20 minutes worth of fiddling to finally get it just right. So pay attention to that if you get it wired, that there's a right way and a wrong way to do that. All right, as I mentioned earlier, the other challenge was getting power from the garage, or in this case actually the house to the garage, and I wasn't too sure whether there was underground conduit that was continuous, and it turns out it was. So we were able to, first we tried to pull the cable through just by attaching the new end and pulling it through, but that wouldn't work, so we ended up running a fish down to the other end and then tying the wire and then pulling that through. So that worked out really well. Now, Mirek also installed this junction box because by code, you can't have just loose wires and the differences in the gauges. So they put this junction box in here and they were able to attach the supply line going out to the charger this way, is in the supply line coming in. You can't see it here behind the box. And then he also corrected a little bit of problems that I had with some electrical switches for my lights, because I have some lights here on the outside of the garage and in the side of the house, and it was on a three-way switch. So I had to modify it in such a way that I could turn on the garage lights on the exterior with one switch and then still turn on the outside lights on the house with another switch. So that was, it's not really related to this, but there's something that was bugging me for the longest time, so he fixed that for me. So here we are, we're in the basement, and this is where the supply line comes into the house, or this is actually the return out to the garage. And again, we had to install a junction box here by code, and ran some proper conduit up there, and then came in, and he's labeled it, you know, Tesla charger there in the garage. We ended up going with a 60 amp double pole breaker, so I have potential 60 amps. Now, continuous load by code in North America is 80%, so that's 48 amps, so that's really good. Now, I should mention, our supply coming into the house is 100 amps, and this is 60, so some of you will be asking, well, why? How can you get away with that with 100 amp? In my case, we have a full gas stove, so there's a 40 amp breaker sitting in here where the stove is actually plugged in, but we only use 110 volts on there to power the electronics. The rest of it is, you know, just kind of free energy. So even though we didn't change the breaker, that just gives us 40 amps that we're not using, and then we can grab whatever else we need. So in my case, you may not be able to do this at home. You may need a 200 amp if you're going this route, but this way we had some headroom, so that's why we went with that. We also don't have a hot water heater using electricity. We have an instant hot water heater. So again, the purpose here is to charge after hours when the peak electricity rates are lower and when the usage in the house is lower. So 60 amps should be really good for us. That's kind of a quick overview. There were no real challenges at this part of the electrical situation. Most of it was really mounting the unit on the outside. All right, so who's gonna do the honors here? My buddy Nick just came over with his Model S. We're gonna give this a go. Supposed to get 48 amp, right? Ladies first. Come on, Beverly.
I don't even know where I'm plugging it in.
I'll show you. Unroll it.
You'll have to learn.
Unroll a little bit of it. There you go. A little bit more. That's probably good enough. Okay.
And then, nope, stop.
Stop.
Press the button on your hand.
Take that wand out of your hand there. And there's a little button right there. Push that right There you go.
Give it a good push.
Correct.
Green. Hey! Okay, check the front. Okay, so.
So now.
Let's have a look at the dash and make sure we're getting. Bring up your charge panel there, buddy.
You got 48 amps.
48. Volts, there we go.
Watt.
Woohoo! Thanks, Merrick.
So you're getting 1 volt.
Good job, buddy. Haha. That's how it's done, folks.